a mystery. You know, I don't know what makes him tick to the extent that he ticks. He's a loner, I think, to a great extent. And I think, you know, sometimes you have to be to work that well and to give so much of yourself. It's hard to divide your attention, your emotion, your energy. I think you have to be single-minded. And he is.
Mir ist es ehrlich gesagt zu grafisch und unemotional. Ich finde natürlich, dass da unten die Trauernden um den
Toten... Ja, das ist Maria, diese trauernde Welt, diese Doppelseite.
Das die lieber, die große, aber...
Ja? Okay, ja, super. Du hast unglaublich viel Elend, siehst du jetzt schon, ne?
Was hier schön ist zum Ausklang der Strecke, dass einer so traurig durch die kaputten Straßen geht, natürlich auch super. Ne? Würde auch sehr gut passen.
Und in Goma war der Irrsinn war natürlich diese 1 Million, von denen Tausende gestorben sind. Das war, wo sie auf der Vulkanerde niemanden beerdigen konnten, wo du diese Leichenberge hattest.
Die Leichenberge,
das zu heavy ist. Aber
das ist natürlich super, das ist ja gut, da hast du die Leichenberge.
Da kann man. Ja, okay, dann brauchst du es nicht nochmal zu machen unbedingt, das ist richtig.
Das sieht toll aus.
Und du meinst wirklich, wir sollen das hier jetzt nehmen?
Den würde ich mal vergrößern. Was natürlich ein super Bild ist, natürlich auch das hier. Ne?
Ja, das können wir aufnehmen. Das ist
die Lachbahnkippe.
Das können wir. Vielleicht müssen wir das doch da hinstellen.
Ja, okay, ist doch gut.
Das nochmal vergrößern.
Ja, okay. Gut. Das würde auch passen vom
Kann man sehen, dass die Leichen, die dort vom Lastwagen gekippt werden, nicht in Afrika sind?
Man muss ja nicht diese Leichenberge hier sehen, sondern dieses hier, dieses da austauschen.
Weil hier hast du das Gefühl, du kriegst eine Afrika-Strecke gebogen. Es fängt mit Afrika an und dann kriegst du gleich wieder ab und dann denkst du, das ist wieder Horror in Afrika. Seine Idee ist ja Horror weltweit.
Das zoomt da wieder rein.
Dann kommt der Kopf.
Dann hast du diesen armen Menschen da.
Der sieht super aus. Genau. Und dann gucken wir uns das nochmal an.
Das ist Katze. Mit dem Fall der Berliner Mauer veränderten sich auch die Kriege. Nicht mehr Land gegen Land, sondern Volk gegen Volk.
Statt Hightech, Waffen, Karabiner und Macheten. Wie kein anderer hat James Nachtwey, berühmtester Kriegsfotograf der Welt, diese neuen Konflikte und ihre Opfer porträtiert.
Noch nie am Zucker. How many people now are missing from the village? And how many people were killed?
12.
Could we please go down there?
Oh, my God, you're dead. My decision to become a photographer was to become a war photographer. I made that decision in the early 70s during Vietnam. The pictures that were coming out of Vietnam were showing us what was really happening on the ground level, and it was in contradiction to what our political leaders and military leaders were telling us. They were straightforward documentary images, a powerful indictment of the war, how unjust it was, how cruel it was, simply by showing what was happening there. And I was very affected by the pictures. And when I finally made the decision of what I wanted to do with my life, that's what I decided I wanted to do, was follow in that tradition. And it took me a long time before I was able to feel confident inside myself that I could do this job. Before I tried to convince other people, I had to first convince myself. And in 1980, I woke up one night with the very clear idea that now I've learned everything I can learn, and now is the time to go to New York and try to become a magazine photographer, a war photographer. I really felt I was ready to do this, to do foreign assignments and go to war zones. And in fact, I began to get work right away. It was a time of very high emotions and great excitement. I really felt I was witnessing history. And witnessing history, not from an academic point of view, not from a distance, but really what happens to people, ordinary people, in the course of history. And this was, you know, to me, the most exciting, most worthwhile experience, and exactly the kind of experience why I became a photographer. That's what I wanted to get across. And there was danger involved in it. There was also, you know, there was a sense of adventure and facing danger and feeling people's authentic emotions. In a way, it was a lot like theater. But instead of being in the audience, I was on the stage, and the script was being written minute by minute as it went along. And you had to kind of understand and anticipate and connect with it emotionally and intellectually, what was going on, so you could follow it. I also had to learn, you know, in taking pictures, how to develop a personal vision, how to express my own feelings about it. And in order to do that, I had to get in touch with my own feelings. And it was a kind of, through photography, through the discipline of the frame, I learned about the world. It became the way in which I discovered the world, and it also became the way which I discovered myself.
Forensic scientists and pathologists will be there with you. They will identify themselves. What we want you to do is come in through there. The smell is pretty bad just there, so just prepare yourself for it. There is a room at the end, but it has bullet holes in. Do not photograph in the other room. Okay, they are not cleared, and we think it wrong that you should photograph what's in there.
And the bullet holes are your proof that what?
Well, but they corroborate other evidence that they were shooting there.
And they say they're doing head counts, means, you know, and they have an anthropologist to match bones to bodies. And...
tell what time. Oh, we're all right. You got a mask?
No, I don't need one.
Let me know when you're ready for the next
ride. Pretty gross.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah.
I came to journalism sort of by accident. And I entered journalism because I thought it would be fun. I thought it would be cool. I thought it would be a great job to be a war correspondent, a foreign correspondent, travel, see the world, be in the middle of things, you know.
Oh, boy.
But then there are certain stories that you do, and they make you think again what you were doing and why you were doing it. And they make you realize that this is serious and important, and you, by the way you cover a story or by the way you tell a story define the way the world sees that story. So you better do it right. You better know what you're doing. I mean, I deeply, deeply believe that. People even now are saying, even now, today, when they see the mass graves, you know, even now they want to doubt.
Oh my goodness, somebody just threw flowers. Look, look behind you.
Ka qitë pjetër këllicën të tukë, ka mund 400 markë e ka shtyja ne e ka vëra. Qetëri më lakë një, ka më prej me t'i këtë bukë, s'pa më njëtë.
Rërkat,
arm was a bread knife. Se ka mund, minja ka njëtë, e ka posë në prejnë, më nuk një ahjek s'ka mund, i ka rënë kry, e ka shtu të një të njëmë prej këllicë, ajo rënë më rekë, a petë për srati ka shtu. Tri ku kënë nga që të prezent së tërë, nëmi ka onë 2 minuta.
In a war, the normal codes of civilized behavior are suspended. It would be unthinkable in so-called normal life to go into someone's home where the family is grieving over the death of a loved one and spend long moments photographing them. It simply wouldn't be done. Those pictures could not have been made unless I was accepted by the people I'm photographing. It's simply impossible to photograph moments such as those without the complicity of the people I'm photographing, without the fact that they welcomed me, that they accepted me, that they wanted me to be there. They understand that a stranger who's come there with a camera to show the rest of the world what is happening to them gives them a voice in the outside world that they otherwise wouldn't have. They realize that they are the victims of some kind of injustice, of some kind of unnecessary violence. And by allowing me there to photograph it, they're making their own appeal to the outside world and to everyone's sense of right and wrong. I try my best to approach people with respect. I want them to see that I have respect for them and the situation they're in. I don't like to move too fast. I don't like to speak too loudly. I want to be very open in my approach. I want to feel open in my own heart towards them, and I want them to be aware of that. And people do sense it. They, with very few words, sometimes with no words at all.
Es gibt Kriegsfotografen, die offensichtlich den Horror dessen, was sie so lange gesehen und erlebt haben, den Horror, dem sie entkommen sind, nur dadurch ertragen können, dass sie entweder, das Klischee wäre Vietnam, mit den Soldaten anschließend in dieselben Bordells gehen, in dieselben Bars, denselben Whisky trinken. Es gibt andere, die darüber zynisch geworden sind. Jim ist eine bemerkenswert unzynische Person. Und das ist umso bemerkenswerter für mich, weil die meisten Menschen, die ich kenne, viel weniger Elend und Leid gesehen haben. Einsam deshalb, weil seine Erfahrung ihn selbst von seinen Kollegen trennt und von vielen anderen. Er ist ein anderer geworden durch das, was er 25 Jahre erlebt hat.
The most incomprehensible situation I've ever witnessed was Rwanda, where, I mean, we don't really know how many people died, an estimate of 500,000 to 1,000,000. They were killed with very primitive weapons, clubs and rocks and machetes, face to face. And I saw some massacre sites, and I just do not understand how people can do that to each other. What can inspire such fear and such hatred is beyond my understanding, really. It's very difficult to get over that.
When the Hutu army and militia were finally defeated, hundreds of thousands of Hutus fled into nearby Tanzania or Zaire. A cholera epidemic swept through the refugee population in Goma, and tens of thousands of people were being wiped out in short order. It just swept through the camps, and I realized that many of the people I were photographing might have been the very ones who had committed the massacres that I had witnessed just a few weeks before. And it was like taking the express elevator to hell.
Aber während wir entweder über diesen Horror erzählten, um uns darüber klar zu werden, was wir da gesehen hatten, ein wahres Inferno von Leichenbergen, von Sterbenden, von Spuckenden, von unendlich langen Schlangen vor den Sanitätszelten, erzählte Jim so gut wie gar nichts. Jim sagte Hallo, Jim redete ein paar organisatorische Details und Jim sagte, ich gehe schlafen. Und während wir das Bier gebraucht haben, um uns zu erholen von dem, was wir am Tag gesehen hatten, hatte Jim, ich weiß es nicht mehr, ein Mineralwasser oder zwei getrunken, sich früh schlafen gelegt, um am nächsten Tage ganz für sich alleine wieder in aller Frühe loszuziehen.
I began to do documentary photographs of poverty, which is very widespread in Indonesia. There's terrible poverty. These are people who have jobs, raise families. It's very much a workers' neighborhood. And this is what they have found themselves in, along the railway tracks. These are not drug addicts or dropouts. They work, they're trying to raise their families. They came in from the countryside looking for a better life, and they simply can't afford normal housing. So they build shacks of abandoned wood and plastic where there's no rent. While I was doing this reportage, I discovered a man who had one arm and one leg. He'd been run over by a train 7 years ago on a drunken night, and somehow managed to survive. He was living with his wife and four children in the gravel between railway tracks. I could see that he was very loving towards his children, that they also loved him in return, that he was trying his best to keep his family together, and spent quite a bit of time documenting the life of this family.
Die frühen 80er Jahre, die waren bei mir sicherlich sehr bestimmt durch einen Umzug nach New York. Ich war Bildredakteurin bei Geo, war vorher beim Spiegel gewesen, hatte eine Möglichkeit, als verantwortliche Bildperson in das New Yorker Sternbüro zu gehen. Das war 1982. Und das war das erste Mal, dass Nachtway mit einem Portfolio in die Sternredaktion kam. Und daraus entstand dann eine freundschaftliche Beziehung. Eine Liebesbeziehung. Wir beide hatten eine Vorstellung, was aus dieser New Yorker Situation entstehen sollte. Und Nachtway wollte sich einen Namen machen. Und er war blitzgescheit und entschlossen. Und er war fokussiert in seinem Vorgehen. Große Luftlinien, Schlangenwege gab es da nicht. Es gab einen klaren, geraden, schmalen, steinigen Weg, den er sich vorgenommen hatte zu gehen. Sicher hätte ich es mir manchmal wärmer, näher, intensiver vorgestellt, aber es war ganz stark im Vordergrund die Arbeit. Ich schaffe es. und ich schaffe das fotografisch. Ich werde mit meinen Bildern Menschen überzeugen. Nachtway kam zurück aus Nicaragua. Er war entspannt, er war fröhlich. Und er brachte mir eine Kette aus Muscheln mit und legte sie mir um den Hals und ich fand es großartig.
Ich erinnere mich an das allererste Mal, als ich ihm begegnet bin. Seine Haare waren gescheitelt, die Jeans hatten eine Bügelfalte, das Hemd war makellos sauber. In all diesem Staub und diesem Aufruhr stand dieser Mann, den ich vorher nie gesehen hatte, da und machte seine Bilder. Bei weitem nicht so hektisch wie die anderen, in aller Ruhe, als neben ihm der südafrikanische Fotograf Ken Osterbroek erschossen wurde. Üblicherweise erwischt es zwei Sorten von Journalisten. Diejenigen, die zum ersten Mal dabei sind und diejenigen, die zu lange dabei sind, weil die nämlich glauben, dass sie bulletproof seien. Und Jim ist in der Gefahr, zu glauben, bulletproof zu sein, einmal zu oft sein Glück versuchen zu wollen. Ich glaube, dass dieser reservierte Mensch, der er ist, den Kick, das Abenteuer, den Adrenalinspiegel und die Todesangst braucht, um sich wirklich lebendig zu fühlen. Dass Jim am besten ist, wenn er am nächsten am Extrem ist.
Pushing the limits, das ist es. Immer wieder Grenzen, Grenzen, Grenzen pushen. Hart. Hart, hart, hart.
So wie es ja wahnsinnig schwer ist, mit Nachtway darüber zu reden, welchen irrsinnigen Situationen er bereits entkommen ist. Manche Fotografen, manche Journalisten sind unerträglich, indem sie gar nicht aufhören können zu erzählen über das, was sie alles erlebt haben. Nachtway muss man das aus der Nase ziehen. Er muss sich bitten lassen, davon zu erzählen. Und auch dann tut er alles dafür, um den Eindruck zu vermeiden, er würde protzen. Angeben.
Wenn er zurückkam von einem Auftrag und man ihn am liebsten halt an den Schultern genommen hätte und gesagt hätte, nun erzähl doch und wie war's? Und nein, da mussten erstmal die Bilder entwickelt werden und da mussten die Bilder angeguckt werden. Ich weiß nicht, wo das alles hingepackt wurde oder immer noch hingepackt wird, weil selbst das, was an Bildmaterial vorhanden ist, Fotos, auch das ist ein Minimum dessen, was gesehen, gespürt, gerochen, gehört wurde. Er hat seine eigene Bibliothek des Leidens im Kopf. Was ging in deinem Kopf vor? Musst du dich nicht aussprechen?
and many children working in this dump on the outskirts of Jakarta. Rather than going to school, they spend their day picking through garbage. Smells horrible. The ground under your feet is like some kind of quagmire. I wore a pair of rubber boots. The people who work there wear rubber sandals. I find it incredible that people are forced to work this way in order to make about 85 cents US a day. And I began by exploring the conditions of poverty in a country which had been celebrated in recent years for this kind of economic revival. I realized this economic revival must be affecting a very small percentage of the population, and that actually there was this ongoing kind of anonymous mass of people living in conditions of dire poverty. And indeed, that's what I discovered. I was very moved, almost shocked, by the superhuman level of emotion that was expressed at the moment of Suharto's resignation. And I wanted to find out what was behind that passion, what could create that level of emotion among so many people. And I realized it had to come from a weight being lifted, the weight of repression, a glimmer of hope for some kind of social and economic equality that had been denied to so many people for so long.
My mother hates the idea of me being a war cameraman.
Listen, I just spoke to Dottie.
Deep down, she's just waiting for the phone call from the office to say, you know, are you, you know, Desmond's mother, et cetera, et cetera. She always thinks that trouble follows me wherever I go, you know, considering I'm now in Indonesia. And I came here, and 2 months later, Suharto resigned. The country was on fire. Thousands of people have been killed. And she calls me up and said, what's going on? You know, you're supposed to be taking, you know, semi-retirement, and look what's happened. It's a very competitive business. The most dramatic pictures are always the ones that get used. And there's a lot of people within the business who are very brutal in the way that they operate, in terms of they're there to get the worst of the worst of the worst, and they will not, I know people who do not help. You know, they say, I'm sorry, I'm a journalist, I'm not part of this, and I say, but you are part of it. I think a lot of people would be quite happy for that man to be killed so they can get that particular picture that they want. It is a sick business to a certain extent. I've got no idea. I've got no idea why we're doing this. It was a Sunday, a week after the clashes between the students and the troops, and I got a call from Jim at 10 o'clock Sunday morning saying, there's a problem. There's something going on here, I don't know what it is. There's a church on fire, there's people on the streets with swords, with machetes, you name it. Something's going to go down. As it happened, half an hour later, they had caught three Ambanese men. They had killed them on the spot. You know, with swords and shit, cut them to pieces, and they found what they were chasing the fourth one through the streets. Jim was basically with them for the entire chase through the streets. He's got black and white pictures of this guy running with this crazy mob behind him, blood streaming from his head. They were playing with him. They were playing with this guy, torturing like you play and little kids play with a puppy. And Jim basically got down on his hands and knees three times, pleading to saying to them, there is no reason for you to kill this man. You know, you've just because he is Ambonese, but they didn't listen. They didn't listen to him, and they killed him anyway. But for 20 minutes, he was on his hands and knees praying, saying, please don't kill this man, there is no need. If the situation does get that brutal and that nasty, a lot of people would move away, A, for their own safety, but I think in a way as an instinctive thing to say, I'm not part of it. Whereas Jim is always he is always right in the middle of it. He is always part of it. He always has been and he always will be. And his pictures tell that. And I think that's why he was on his hands and knees that day, was because he was right in the middle. I know friends of mine who were there, they went next to this guy when he was getting killed. They were standing on a bridge or in a building or, you know, just shooting from a distance. And when it becomes up close and personal, that's Jim.
That's very important, to stay centered inside yourself, because you have to make a lot of very important decisions very quickly. You have to stay calm and you can't get too excited or panicked about things. I mean, these are all very basic things that probably even I shouldn't mention. I just try and focus, pre-visualize situations I might get in and run them through my mind. And I think it's very subconscious how I prepare myself mentally.
Thank you.
every situation is different than the next. And everyone requires that you learn these things all over again, every time you go out. And a lot of it was instinct. A lot of it is knowledge and absorbing information and coming to some kind of innate understanding of events. Fear is not what's important, it's how you deal with it. It would be like asking a marathon runner if they feel pain. It's not a matter of whether you feel it, it's how you manage it. It could happen to any of us at any time. And we all know that this is a distinct possibility every time we go out, every day. It's what we face. It comes with the territory. It's part of the job. We go in knowing that from the beginning. Nobody feels sorry for themselves. It's just, you know, part of it. I think you're on the right track.
Ich glaube, dass James Nachtways Bilder die Präzision eines Kriegschirurgen haben. Er hasst das zu hören. Er möchte nicht mit einem Kriegschirurgen gleichgesetzt werden, und zwar deshalb, weil alle dann gleich sagen, aha, Kriegschirurg gleich kalt.
It just seems a touch light overall for the,
you know,
to bring out the full drama.
other thing that I could do is just give a light burn around the head here.
And maybe this area as well. When it gets overall darker, keep this area as it is now. Don't let that go darker.
Go any darker, okay.
Ist ja rigoros im Umgang mit Leuten und wie mit Situationen. Das ist dieses Altmodische, dieses Unmoderne. Das, was ihn aber auch untypisch und damit so faszinierend macht.
Okay.
I agree. Thank you.
Good luck.
Work pretty good too.
Oh, very good idea. You'll see more of the forms of the destruction. Do you think you can get more out of the sky?
Definitely.
Looking very good. I would try one where you even get more out of the sky.
Go further with it.
See what I mean?
The sky makes all the difference.
I feel as if I've spent at least half of my career working in Africa in one context or another. One of those contexts, certainly the saddest, the most tragic, the most destructive, have been famines. Primarily, these famines were not natural famines. They were a product of war. It's conceivably the oldest weapon of mass extermination known to man. It's very primitive. And yet it's very effective. It's important for readers of publications to understand that most of the pictures they see of famine victims are taken in feeding centers. They're taken in places where food has been sent. We're not taking pictures of people who are starving and not trying to help them. We're not turning our back on them and walking away. It's more difficult to get publications to focus on issues that are more critical. It's never been easy, and I think in the last few years it's gotten more and more difficult as society becomes more obsessed with entertainment and celebrity and fashion. Advertisers are tired of having their products displayed next to images of human tragedy. They feel that it somehow detracts from the saleability of their products. The main purpose of my work is to appear in the mass media. It's not so much that I want my pictures to be looked upon as art objects as it is a form of communication. Whatever I did that accomplished something, I'm glad for it. But it's, you know, there's always so much more to do. I've never felt
complete. I've never felt satisfied. I wouldn't say I could use the word happy about it because it's always involved other people's tragedies and other people's misfortunes. At best, there's a kind of grim satisfaction that perhaps I've brought some attention, focused people's attention on these problems. Perhaps it brought some relief, but it's shifting sand. It keeps moving.
Where is this again? Where were you?
Many places. The chain gang was Alabama. Some of the police work is New Orleans. Okay. Some is New York. Some is Los Angeles.
I think this is one of the most powerful walls. Yeah, because it hits home. It's the U.S. It's brutality.
It's not like things are wrong everywhere else in the world and everything is okay here. We have our own problem.
Exactly.
Show's going up in the last minute. They're still working, huh? Look at this, Jimmy. 6 o'clock. It's almost showtime.
About time. Huh?
20 years, bud.
Wow.
Oof. What's it feel? Since being tired, you must be.
I'm tired.
Yeah.
A little shell-shocked by it all.
But triumphant, huh? I mean, this is...
I've been talking too much, basically.
Yeah.
And I just feel kind of talked out. Man, once you stood by me all that time.
Wow.
When this is over, we ought to head for the Sierras.
Definitely head for the Sierras.
We met at Dartmouth College in the late 60s. And we were in our young 20s then, full of piss and vinegar and... trying to figure out what we wanted to do in life.
I mean, you spent a lot of time doing this.
Months, you know, man.
20 years.
Yeah.
20 years on this thing.
Yeah. He won for the third time the ICP Infinity Award for photojournalism. He's won the Robert Capa Prize 5 times. And Picture of the Year, I don't know how many times. It's my pleasure, Jim Nachtwey.
I was young, I was starting, I was green, I was excited, I was interested in adventure, I was interested in travel. Over the years, the real sense of purpose became stronger. The people I photographed were much more important than myself.
I think he thinks that good will triumph eventually over evil with all the setbacks en route, but I think that's what keeps him straight in his own head about what he's doing. I think his optimism keeps him from being cynical finally. You can get off the tracks pretty easily if you started thinking that what you're doing isn't going to make a difference, that the wars will go on forever and ever and ever. think the main conflict is whether there's at any point in his life when he can give up what he's doing, because there are no old combat photographers for good reason. So what do you do if you're lucky enough, touch wood, to get through the gauntlet of your job and of your life? And, you know, Jim's been wounded 4 or 5 times and has had terrible diseases and terrible physical trauma to his life.
And how do you control your emotions in front of such a situation?
Because I have to. Because for me to go to these places and cave in would be useless. What I do is I channel my emotions into my work. Any anger that I'm feeling, frustration, disbelief, grief, I try and channel it into my pictures.
The possibility of a normal life is the main conflict, and what he's had to sacrifice to lead the life that he leads. So having a family and having a stable, romantic, domestic environment, because he's never been able to have one. He's given everything to the job.
It's more difficult to get publications to focus on issues that are more critical, that do not provide people with an escape from reality, but attempt to get them deeper into reality, to be concerned about something much greater than themselves. And I think people are concerned. I think quite often publishers don't give their audience enough credit for that. In fact, at the end of the day, I believe people do want to know when there's some major tragedy going on, when there's some unacceptable situation happening in this world, and they want something done about it. That's what I believe. May 22nd. Dear Mr. Noctway, I read the story concerning the Sumarno family and my soul could not rest and cannot imagine the hardship and turmoil this family is enduring. I don't have much. I get only $396 a month, Social Security, but I will try and send $20 a month for the family as long as I am able. We must look at it. We're required to look at it. We're required to do what we can about it. If we don't, who will?
Verdiene ich mein Geld mit dem Leid anderer Menschen? Ist deren Leid und deren Elend meine Leiter zum Erfolg gewesen? Nutze ich aus? Bin ich der Blutsauger? Der Vampir mit der Kamera?
Thank you.
Jim.
Jim. Mon ami. Mon ami.
Why photograph war? Is it possible to put an end to a form of human behavior which has existed throughout history by means of photography? The proportions of that notion seem ridiculously out of balance, yet that very idea has motivated me. For me, the strength of photography lies in its ability to evoke a sense of humanity. If war is an attempt to negate humanity, then photography can be perceived as the opposite of war. And if it's used well, it can be a powerful ingredient in the antidote to war. In a way, if an individual assumes the risk of placing himself in the middle of a war in order to communicate to the rest of the world what is happening, he's trying to negotiate for peace. Perhaps that's the reason why those in charge of perpetuating a war do not like to have photographers around. In the field, what you experience is extremely immediate. What you see is not an image on a page in a magazine 10,000 miles away with an advertisement for Rolex watches on the next page. What you see is unmitigated pain, injustice, and misery. It's occurred to me that if everyone could be there just once to see for themselves what white phosphorus does to the face of a child, or what unspeakable pain is caused by the impact of a single bullet, or how a jagged piece of shrapnel can rip someone's leg off. If everyone could be there to see for themselves the fear and the grief just one time, then they would understand that nothing is worth letting things get to the point where that happens to even one person, let alone thousands. But everyone cannot be there. And that is why photographers go there, to show them, to reach out and grab them and make them stop what they're doing and pay attention to what is going on, to create pictures powerful enough to overcome the diluting effects of the mass media and shake people out of their indifference, to protest, and by the strength of that protest, to make others protest.
Does it cause them any health problems? Asap di sana, asap belerang kan bisa bikin mata perih juga. Ya, ya. Ada untuk kesehatan, merusak kesehatan nggak?
Oh, nggak ada. Sisanya nggak ada, Pak. Nggak ada.
Asap. Oh, they say they are coughing sometimes when they are there, but when they return, they will get something from Suhar, I believe, like a milk together with green porridge, and then normal again.
The worst thing is to feel that as a photographer I'm benefiting from someone else's tragedy. This idea haunts me. It's something I have to reckon with every day because I know that if I ever allow genuine compassion to be overtaken by personal ambition, I will have sold my soul. The only way I can justify my role is to have respect for the other person's predicament. The extent to which I do that is the extent to which I become accepted by the other. And to that extent, I can accept myself.